I tested every single Sony camera to find the best ones. Sony has amazing technology and a camera for almost anyone, but picking the right Sony camera can be a bit overwhelming. Sony has multiple camera series with sub-series and even multiple versions of the same camera with different design. And just because the camera looks good on paper doesn't mean it's right for you. So in this video, I'm going to make it super simple for you by telling you the best Sony cameras depending on your shooting style and budget and which version of the camera is right for you. Also, I'll leave links down below with the best pricing on all the cameras we talk about today. Now, if you're looking for a Sony camera that's a jack of all trades, aka a good hybrid camera, Sony actually has two cameras that might be perfect for you. And that is the Sony A7C Mark II and the Sony A7 IV. But these are just the first cameras on this list, and there's other cameras later on in this list that might be a better fit for you if you're on a budget, if you're mainly focused on video, or if you want a powerhouse of a professional camera. When it comes to the A7C Mark II and the A7 IV, the two cameras are pretty similar, but they have some pretty major differences, and the right one will really depend on your specific shooting style. They both have a 33 megapixel full frame sensor, which is an incredible amount of resolution for cropping in and zooming into your footage, and you can touch up even the smallest detail when it comes to editing. Both cameras have a super solid and sticky autofocusing system, but to be honest, every single Sony camera on this list has good autofocus, and because Sony is so far ahead of the competition when it comes to autofocus, there's really no such thing as a Sony camera with bad autofocus. One advantage of the A7C II over the A7 IV is that it also has AI-based autofocus that can intelligently recognize subjects like animals, humans, cars, trains, insects, and the list goes on. And this AI-based autofocus is the most advanced autofocusing system from any company. The A7 IV does not have AI-based autofocus, but also has face and eye detect. But the A7 IV has its own advantages, as you'll see later on. Both cameras are also pretty decent in low light shooting, and both cameras also have in-body stabilization that's going to give you very smooth handheld footage for video. The A7 II does technically have better stabilization, however, I doubt anyone will notice unless you're really looking. Both cameras can shoot at a pretty fast 10 frames per second, which is decent enough for most action, but the A7 IV can actually shoot 800 uncompressed raw frames in a row, where the A7C Mark II can only shoot 44 frames in a row before the camera needs a break. So the A7 IV is a much better camera for action shooters that need to shoot for a long period of time. However, in JPEG mode, they both shoot 1,000 JPEGs in a row, which is crazy, but in JPEG mode, both cameras should perform just about the same. In video mode, both cameras also have 4K at 24 and 30 frames per second that is downsampled from 7K. So you're literally getting almost double the resolution of 4K, but in a smaller 4K file size. Both cameras can also shoot 4K at 60 frames per second for 2x slow motion. However, you do have a 1.6x crop which zooms into your image. It isn't ideal, but you can still shoot full HD at 60 and 120 frames per second without a crop. And all these frame rates can also be shot with high data rates anywhere between 200 to 600 megabits per second with 10-bit color at 422 with S-Log3 and cinema profiles, making them very easy cameras to color grade, but also good enough for professional use. And the rest of the cameras on this list also have high data rates with 10-bit color, 422, and cinema profiles built in. So all of the cameras on this list are also very good for video editing. Now, the biggest difference between the A7C II and the A7 IV really comes down to the design, because like I said earlier, Sony often makes the same camera, but radically changes the design to better fit different shooting styles. The A7 IV has a beefy pro-style body with a very robust grip with 4 custom buttons and a joystick for changing your autofocus points. The A7 II, however, has no joystick, but it does have 2 custom buttons. And the A7 IV also has dual SD card slots where you can individually record photos to one card and video to another card, or just have a redundant backup, but the A7 II only has 1 SD card slot. But what is the same is that both cameras have 3 custom presets on the mode dial, so you can set these cameras up for different shooting scenarios like 4K 60, 4K 24, and nighttime shooting. And there's also a toggle to quickly switch between photo, video, and slow motion modes. But the biggest difference is that the A7C II literally fits in the palm of your hands. Both cameras are very powerful hybrid cameras, and the right camera for you really depends on if you need a beefy, robust, professional style body, or if you prefer something more small and nimble for more casual photography, or if you're a professional that wants a fun B camera. But if you're looking for a powerful hybrid camera without moving up into the extreme professional line of Sony cameras, these are the two best options for you. And as much as I love these cameras, a lot of you guys may not need this much power in your camera, and maybe you'd rather save a bit of money. And if you want a powerful hybrid camera, but at a pretty massive discount, you can still get about 80% of the features of the A7 IV and the A7C II, but save almost $1,000 with your camera. So the next camera might just be perfect for you, and that is the Sony A6700. It has a 20 megapixel APS-C size sensor, which is about 1.6 times smaller than a full frame sensor. The main difference with a sensor like this is that you get a more narrow field of view, which might be better for certain shooting styles like sports, wildlife, or travel shooting, where you're shooting things far away and your sensor is already zoomed in, so you get more range out of your lenses. Plus, it's only about 7 megapixels less, which you probably won't notice. But the A6700 does have a dual native ISO for 800 and 2500, making it a really good low light camera, and you can push this camera a lot further. And it also has the same ultra-reliable Sony autofocus from the A7C Mark II, with AI-based subject tracking. And again, this is the most advanced autofocusing system in cameras right now, and it has the same 7 stops of stabilization from the A7C Mark II. In terms of photos, the A6700 can shoot slightly faster at 11 frames per second and can shoot 59 RAW photos and 1,000 JPEGs in a row. So in terms of shooting speed, it's pretty on par with the much more expensive A7C Mark II, but for almost $1,000 less. In terms of video, the A6700 has phenomenal video. It shoots 4K at 24, 30, and 60 frames per second that is also downsampled from the 6K image area, giving you 6K quality and detail, but in a smaller, more nimble 4K file size. And it also shoots 4K at 120 frames per second, sadly with a 1.6 times crop, which isn't ideal, but that's a pretty crazy feature to see in a camera like this, and it's a feature you don't really see unless it's a professional camera. And just like the other cameras, it also has 10-bit color, 422, with cinema profiles, so if you wanna do some serious video editing, go nuts. And the A6700 has a pretty similar body to the A7C Mark II. It's a great hybrid body with an electronic viewfinder and a side articulating screen with touch autofocus and touch controls. And it also has 2 custom buttons with a toggle to quickly switch between photo, video, and slow motion. So you're getting a lot of the design language of the more expensive A7C Mark II, but in a more affordable camera. And the A6700 also only has 1 SD card slot. If you're a hybrid shooter, the A6700 is a very solid choice if you're looking for a more affordable APS-C size camera without sacrificing all the other important features like autofocus, stabilization, and high data rates. Now, if you want the very best when it comes to resolution and performance from a Sony camera, the next 2 cameras are exactly what you're looking for, the A7R V and the A7CR. Both cameras have a ridiculous 60 megapixel full frame sensor, and this is one of the highest resolution sensors that you can get in a full frame mirrorless camera. Compared to other cameras that are maybe 26, 33 megapixel sensors, this is basically double the resolution. You can literally zoom in and see someone's pores and even the eyelashes on their face. Again, this is only going to matter to you if you really care about resolution, but this high resolution sensor has benefits for both photos and videos. And both cameras also have the same AI-based autofocus, which is simply spectacular, and I've talked a lot about it in this video. And they both have the same 7-stop in-body stabilization. And when you're shooting photos with a ridiculous 60 megapixel resolution sensor, this is where things get really exciting. The A7R V shoots at 10 frames per second, but has a ridiculous frame buffer of 538 raw photos in a row, meaning you can pretty much shoot forever. But you can only get this feature if you're using a faster CF Express Type A card, and most of us mere mortals are probably just shooting on a pretty inexpensive SD V90 card probably, and you guys will probably get something closer to 41 to 49 uncompressed raw photos in a row. The A7CR is slightly slower at 8 frames a second, but you can still shoot 36 raw frames in a row. For a smaller and cheaper camera, this is still pretty decent and pretty much just about as good as the A7C II. But both cameras can also shoot 1,000 JPEGs in a row. When it comes to video, the 2 cameras perform almost the same. They can both shoot 4K at 24 and 30 frames per second and 60 frames per second with a slight 1.2 times crop, which is barely noticeable, so let's just call it uncropped. And they can also shoot full HD at 60 frames per second and 120 frames per second for slow motion. The one advantage of the A7R V is that it can also shoot 8K video, but it's got a little bit of rolling shutter that's really noticeable with a camera shake, and it's only 420 10-bit color. The 8K video isn't perfect, but it's a really cool feature to have. And both cameras can shoot 10-bit color with cinema profiles, but the one cool thing about the A7R V is that you can also record ProRes RAW out using an external recorder. And in terms of body and design, it's a pretty similar deal as the A7 IV and the A7C II. The A7R V is more of a pro style body with more custom buttons, and the A7C R has slightly less custom buttons and no joystick, but it's a smaller and more nimble camera. And they both have a side articulating screen with touch controls and touch autofocus. But the one cool thing about the A7R V is that the screen on the back can both work as a side articulating screen and a tilt screen. And this is going to be a pretty big deal if you're a serious shooter. But for the most part, it just comes down to if you're a pro shooter or if you want a smaller, sleeker body. Both the A7R V and the A7C R are very powerful hybrid cameras, especially if you're someone that's into resolution. The A7C R does have a slight reduction in power, but considering what you're getting in that camera, it comes at a really good price. And if you want the best possible pricing on any of the cameras we talked about today, make sure to check out the links in the description down below, and I will see you guys in the next video. Peace.